Hey everybody, my name is Bri Blagowsky. You might recognize me from kids camp over the years as rec staff, as an intern, as a counselor, and also I taught sixth grade Sunday school this past year. I am honored that Pastor Ivy and others asked me to be a part of your at-home camp, and I hope that you are just as excited as me to share this message with you as you are to receive it from me. So before we start any message, we always want to start off in prayer for God to open our hearts and minds to receive what He wants us to receive. But I have to be honest, y'all. Sometimes I don't know exactly what to say in my prayer, and what better place to go than His Word to decide what I want to say. So I have a Bible verse, and this is actually going to be our prayer before we start. So you can read along with me. It says, "Open my eyes that I may see wonderful things out of your law." Psalm 119:18. I love that when I can't think of my own words to pray with, God gives me His Word, and He gives me the perfect words that open up what we're going to talk about. So before we start on what we are going to learn about today, I want us to review some things from the first two Bible studies. And you guys, you'll see on my intro, I'm a teacher, so I'm all about charts and visuals. So we have a lot of awesome posters that you guys get to follow along with me. So we've talked about the four purposes that Jesus followed while He was here on earth. Number one comes from Colossians 1:15, and that reminds us that He reflected God's image. He acted in a way to be a human version of God on earth. Number two, John 4:34, He worked. He worked hard every day. It was not always an easy job, but He never stopped persevering and putting in the effort that God called Him to make. Number three, John 15:12-14. He had relationships with people, y'all. Jesus looked like you and me on earth, and He had friends just like you and me on earth. I think that's so huge because that's one of the biggest parts of our fellowship. And number four, Luke 6:12, He spent time with God. So you might be thinking that those four purposes are really hard and thinking, "Miss Bri, how can I fulfill some of those four purposes?" Let me let you guys in on a little secret. Jesus did not do that alone. Y'all, He could not have fulfilled those four purposes without following and committing Himself to God. And the same thing is asked by us multiple times throughout the Bible. Jesus says, "Follow me." Now, your next question might be, what does it mean to fully follow Him and commit to Him? It means that we trust Him, no matter if we understand where His path is or is not going, and we just know that we are on the right path according to Him, and we follow Him without blinking a second eye. So I have a fun visual for this one, y'all. So this right here is a picture of a tandem bike. Now, I will be honest with you. I might be a little bit older than you, but when I was preparing for this Bible study, I had never seen a picture of this either. So a tandem bike is really interesting because you might be able to see it has two seats, right? It does have two handlebars, and it has two pedals. So both people are having to put in work, and both people have a seat to sit on, and both people have handlebars to hold. But the wild thing is, the second seat, all you're doing is pedaling. Your handlebars actually don't steer anything. It's just so you can have balance and hold on. So the front person is in charge of steering the entire bike. We are this backseat passenger. Jesus is in the front of the bike. I would not get on this two-person bike if it's not with somebody that I trust. And it's the same exact thing as our walk with God. You jump into it with full trust in Him, knowing that He is going to not only steer you in the right direction, but also put you onto the right path in the first place. So right now, I want us to take a minute, and you are going to have some reflection time with those around you. During your conversation, you're going to talk about a couple of things. One, the things that could be scary and the things that could be awesome about riding that two-person bike. And two, the things that could be scary and the things that are awesome about your walk with Christ. So just in case you didn't pause and you're talking to somebody around you, I invited my very special friend, Pastor Ivy, out with me. You might recognize her just a little bit. So Pastor Ivy, will you share with our awesome campers maybe a way that it was a little bit scary in your walk with God, but then you saw his glory at the end of that tunnel.
Yeah. So I think, like that picture of the tandem bike, that a lot of times, you know, you're in behind, you know, you can see where Jesus is going. This is the way you should go, but it feels really scary because it's like, are you sure? But what's that going to look like? And I don't know what's ahead. And probably one of the more recent examples of that was in the spring. And we were all in it together because all of a sudden coronavirus hit and our whole world looked different, didn't they? Like all the things that we were used to doing, we couldn't do anymore. And as I looked ahead to our summer, I had been very excited about kids camp and taking all of our kids to kids camp. I was also really excited about AMX in July. And I kept praying, okay, God, what do you want me to do? Like, is this something we're supposed to do? And I felt like, you know, if we think about that visual of the bike, I really felt like Jesus was sitting in the front going, no, Ivy, this is the way. And it's different than what you had in mind. But ultimately, what I felt confident about is that Jesus was going, hey, kids camp is not for this summer. AMX is not for this summer. But the at-home family camp is. And so then I get to see, like, the families that register for at-home family camp and what God had in store. Like, I could never have imagined how much fun things he had in store, and that you could be a part of it. I couldn't see that, but following Jesus, I realized, like, he has good plans for us.
So thank you, Pastor Ivy, for helping me out. We'll see you later.
All right.
So this next part, guys, we are going to walk into five different parts of the Bible that specifically talk about when Jesus says to follow me. They're five very different things that have very different messages, but have the same end meaning that we receive, which is to follow him. So right now, I want you to take a second and go get a Bible. If that is a physical Bible, amazing. If it's the internet right next to you on your computer or an iPad or phone, it doesn't matter. But I'd love for you to read along. So our first verse comes from Matthew, and it's Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. And it reads, and he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Guys, the first time I heard this verse, I kind of laughed. Jesus, he's a funny guy in my mind. He makes all these images and like metaphors that we kind of have to figure out, right? So I thought, fishers of men. Last time I checked, when you go fishing for fish, right? But then I reread it, and I thought about it, and I realized fishing back then was a dominant job. A lot of people fished for work. So Jesus, as much as he had these kind of pickles, mind pickles, I call them, that we had to figure out, he liked to pick things that could relate to the people of the time. So a lot of people are fishermen, so they could relate to this analogy. So first of all, when you're a fisherman, it's hard work, right? And then second of all, the second part of that verse says, fisher of men. When it talks about of men, he's talking about the relationships that they're building. So when he says, go out and make disciples of all nations, that is that analogy, that image of almost hooking people in and bringing them into Christ. And that is through hard work and building relationships with people. Now, if your ears are ringing, you're like, oh, I've heard that somewhere before. Guys, that's one of the first four purposes that we talked about in the very beginning. So our next one is in Luke, and it's chapter 9, verse 23. And this one says, and he said to all, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Deny himself. I also had to look into this and see what this meant a little bit more, because it seems very intense and something that I might not be able to do as a kid or as an adult in different walks of life. But guys, denying yourself is putting him first. It's putting your own personal wants aside to want what God has for you more than what you want for yourself. It's personal sacrifice. So right now we're gonna take our second moment to stop and talk to someone that is with you. And again, if you don't have somebody that's with you, you're not comfortable leading this conversation, I have another friend that I'm going to invite out here to help me talk through this conversation. You might recognize her. She might've led one of the Bible studies earlier, but if you're at home doing this on your own, before we get started, I want you to talk about a couple things. What does it look like to deny yourself and put God first at your age?
All right, friends, so this is my good friend, Katie Kilpatrick. You recognize her. She led one of the other Bible studies, so I'm so happy that she offered to help me out, too. Miss Katie, will you please tell our awesome campers a time that you had to put yourself aside, you had to give a personal sacrifice to remember the plan that God had for you?
Well, one example that comes to mind is just being a mom. I have 4-year-old twins. And I thought that I was not a super selfish person. And then I had children and I realized, oh wait, I just thought about myself all the time and what I wanted to eat and when I wanted to sleep and what I wanted to do with my free time. And so I know that the Lord wants me to think of others as, you know, as well as I think of myself or as much as I think of myself. So that's been a journey, you know, to realize how much God loves us and how he goes out of his way to take care of us. And we need to do the same, go out of our way to take care of others. And I also think about the way that I spend my free time. When I have a night with nothing to do and my chores are done, you know, and my work is done, sometimes I think, well, great, like, let's just do exactly what I want. But sometimes I need to remind myself, let me think about others. Like, do I have a neighbor that just had a baby that I could help right now or something like that? It's just not all about me and that I need to use my time, my resources, my money, my energy, to do kind things for other people and to love them.
I love that example. And first of all, guys, it's not easy to be vulnerable and share about times that you might have been selfish and you had to do self-reflection. So thank you for sharing that and showing them that these open, honest conversations are super important to have. For me, you know, even though you're going to laugh because it's kind of the opposite of what you said, but even though I'm 24 years old, live on my own, have my own job, my own, you know, life, I still go to my parents for a lot of stuff. And my parents still correct me on a lot of stuff. But my parents are two of the wisest people I know, and they have committed their lives to following Christ. And sometimes, just like Jesus, they see things that I can't because they've raised me. They've seen me throughout my whole life. So there are definitely times where I might get frustrated with them. And instead of reacting and lashing out and being rude and negative, I decide to take a breath and to hear what they're trying to say first and then have a response.
I love that. That's really mature. You're talking about laying down your pride to accept feedback, accept correction.
Thank you to my friend Katie. I appreciate you coming out. So the next couple come from John, and our first one is in chapter 10, verse 27. And it says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." So in this verse, Jesus is using the image of he is the shepherd and his followers are the sheep. And when they hear him call, when they hear him giving those directions, they follow him. But you might be thinking, you always tell me, Miss Bri, to listen for God and to go on the path that he's guiding me on. Well, how do I know it's him? How do I know it's him talking to me? Well, you guys, when literal sheep, if you're talking about sheep and a shepherd, when they first are entered into the flock, they don't know who their shepherd is right away. They know him after they spend time with him, right? He goes out there every day. It's his job. He calls them with the same voice and the same heart. And then they learn to trust and follow him. And it's the same thing with us. Until we spend more and more time with Jesus, we won't know how to recognize his voice. But when we do spend time with him, we know that he talks to us in many different ways, and we know to leap on that call when we hear. Our next one is in John again, chapter 12, verse 26. It says, "If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him." The plans that Jesus has for each one of us is different, and they look different. Some of us have physical limitations. We might have a shorter life, or we might have more money. And some of us might even take up the jobs of being actual missionaries and traveling to different countries and cities in his name. But what Jesus wants us to understand is that we are called to follow him without worrying about the paths of others. Just back to that shepherd and sheep image, guys. If you're a new sheep into that flock, you're not going to recognize his voice at first, but the ones around you do. and you naturally follow their, you follow them because they trust the shepherd. It's the same thing with our walk with Christ. If you are on your walk and you are focused on your path and what you need to do, you are naturally emitting kindness. That's a part of God's path. And a part of his path is making disciples of all nations. So if you trust that he's going to put you in the right places with the right people, then he will. And you can worry about your own path and not theirs. The very last one is in John, again, chapter 21, verse 22. Jesus said to him, "If it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? You follow me." So guys, this can go back to that two-person bike picture, that just like the person in the front, they are the only one that can see the entire path in front of them and the person in the back can't. It's the same exact thing with our walk with Christ. He is the only one that can see the full plan for us, see the full path for us, and it is our job to trust and follow him completely. Okay, guys, so those are five times in the Bible that are examples of when Jesus says to follow me. I hope that one of those pulled you in and you could relate to one of those and it really connected with you and you were able to do some personal reflection. The last thing that I want us to do is an activity that you guys are going to do at home. So even at your age, it's important to know specific ways that you can arrange your mindset to better follow Jesus and follow his path. So during this time, I'm going to play a song in the background called Come to the Altar. It's going to be playing on your screen, so I encourage you to leave it on and listen and meditate within these words and see what they have to say for you. So I chose this song because it talks about no matter what stage of life you're in, that Jesus is waiting with open arms. So we're talking about vulnerability. I want to tell you one of my favorite parts in a way that I know how to worship. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Guys, his arms are open. He's waiting for you to be vulnerable and to follow him. So during this time, I want you to get a sheet of paper out and just write a couple ways down that you can follow Jesus while you have those words playing in the background. And then we will close with a prayer right after.
Are you hurting, broken, thin, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. The Father's arms are open wide.
All right, guys, so I hope that that reflection activity really helped you and was solid for you, and you made some relations and learned how you yourself, at whatever age you are, can follow Jesus. So I want us to all close in prayer. So please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for teaching us and loving us. Please help us continue to learn with open minds and follow you. In your heavenly name, amen. Thanks, guys.